It was really exciting and wonderful to listen to both of my co-guests and, you know, my friends actually speak. Kinshuk and I go some time back, not as long as he went, you know, with Chandrababu Naidu and Modi sir, but nevertheless, we do go some way back. And yes, Sangeeta obviously is a dear friend. And it was wonderful. This is the first time I actually heard Sangeeta speak, because in any meeting that I participated, she was either chairing or she was cheering or she was doing something else altogether, but she never spoke actually. So today is the first time she actually spoke, and she spoke very, very eloquently with a lot of passion. Really loved your speech. And another disclaimer right at the onset, I could be very incoherent because I really haven't come very well prepared. And so I either take the two options available here. I could speak extempore and, you know, eloquently, hopefully, like Sangeeta, or humorously and incoherently like Kinshuk. I have two options. I'm going to take the middle path and try and do something here. So I keep telling a lot of people, a lot of those souls who are a little confused, a lot of those people who are a little flustered, I keep telling lots of them, and to those journalists who keep covering my meetings, this might sound a little repetitive, but nevertheless, I keep telling a lot of people, up until 2nd of June, we were in a state called Andhra Pradesh. After 2nd of June, we are in a state called Telangana, geographically speaking, politically, geographically, etc. But the real thing I keep telling a lot of people that I bump into in Hyderabad is that we are actually in a state of transition, we are actually in a state of flux. Most of us, in fact, most of us have a lot of questions, most of us have a lot of issues, you know, most of us actually carry the baggage of why bifurcation, how it should have been done, if it was done, and was it handled well, was it done improperly, etc., etc. There are a lot of questions. But one thing that we all need to realize, India is a country that really does not have a scientific rationale for the creation of new states. One has to realize this is a reality, and this is hard reality. On the one hand, we have Goa, a very, very small, minuscule piece of our country as a state. And on the other hand, we have something as big as Uttar Pradesh, which is actually the sixth largest administrative unit in the world, as also as a state. So in our country, there has never been a scientific rationale for the creation of a state. So point I'm trying to make is, reality is we have two states now, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. We have two chief ministers, we have two governments. So whatever be the opinions, whatever be the serious apprehensions that one had, I think time for all of us to realize that this has happened, and now time for all of us to move on and actually look at the road ahead. And that's exactly what today's topic is. So first things first, I think as the government of Telangana, the people who actually have fought with a lot of conviction, because as Sangeeta had said, not just 24 months ago, but in fact when our chief minister started off with this mission called Telangana, lots of people have ruled him out. They said this was mission impossible. This was about 13 years ago when he started off, because this was a forgotten issue. Back in 70s and 50s, 60s, there were movements and there were murmurs later on, but this was a forgotten issue by and large. But when our chief minister actually revived it, in the form of his political outfit called Telangana Rashtra Samiti. Nobody gave him a shot. Nobody actually gave him a long shot. But it goes to show you that if you actually believe in something with conviction, if you actually practice it, if you have the tenacity, if you have the grit and the resoluteness, things can be done. Mission Impossibles actually can be altered and actually be achieved. So goes to show you what can be done if you actually have the people on your side. In fact, in the last 13 years, the couple of things that really I've learned, especially the last 5 years after being elected as a member of Legislative Assembly, that don't take anything for granted. That's the one thing I've learned. Because in the initial days that we got elected, 2009, we were crestfallen. Our party had lost. Our party was in doldrums. We only were 10 MLAs. We only had out of the 45 people that were that contested as part of an alliance, only 10 members had won, and I was one of them. And the road ahead seemed quite gloomy, to put it very mildly. Nobody could have envisioned, nobody could have imagined that 5 years later, exactly 5 years later, we would be in today's position in a new state, governing the new state actually. So the one thing I've learned, let's not take anything for granted, and that's something that I take very seriously. So even this newfound stardom, newfound ministership, newfound epithets that are being used, I don't take them seriously. I believe that while you're given a chance, while you're given an opportunity, I think you need to work, and that's about it, and the rest is not really in your hands. So having said that, there are some clear priority areas for this new government as far as the new state is concerned. One, we believe that there has been willful neglect. We believe that there are areas which need correction. There are areas where course correction is a must. And so therefore, we've charted our course, we charted our plans. In fact, our chief minister has put in a lot of effort right before the election into drafting our election manifesto, which truly is a blueprint of our vision for the future state of the state of Telangana. In fact, our chief minister spent considerable amount of time interacting with the editors of various Telugu newspapers, interacting with lots of academicians, lots of intellectuals, lots of people from various spheres of life into drafting this comprehensive blueprint. And I'm merely going to put some of those ideas in front of you. The priority areas, obviously, as the speakers before had mentioned, one obviously is Telangana. While it is a very urban state, in fact, we are about 39% of Telangana is urbanized, because thanks largely to Hyderabad and Rangareddy districts and lots of other corporations that we have, such as Khammam, Karimnagar, Ramgundam, Nizamabad, and then lots of municipalities as well. Telangana is predominantly urban. It's 39% urban and 61% rural. The challenge that we have right now, right at the onset, is actually to ensure that while this whole concept of urbanization is definitely in the upswing, is on the upswing, lots of people actually migrating to cities in the lookout, in the search for a job, livelihood, etc., etc. The challenge is this. While Sangeeta spoke about smart cities and how Modi Saab is talking about 100 smart cities, Kinshuk was asking me from the site. I said, do you know what a smart city is? I said, I have no idea. Everybody seems to be talking about it, but nobody seems to have a clue, you know, in the proper definition. A ubiquitous, all acceptable definition, nobody seems to have it. Because just this morning I met a couple of service providers and each of them claimed that they have a smart city solution. So yes, the idea is obviously we want smart cities, we want safe cities, we want green cities, we want cities that actually are reflection of the best that there is, you know, when human minds actually apply themselves. Absolutely, there's no second thought about that. But at the same time, the challenge is also to stem this urbanization, like in the US or like elsewhere in the developed part of the world. The challenge is really to also provide the same urban amenities in the rural areas as well. We do have a very, very interesting challenge ahead. Because while, yes, we do want our cities to decongest, we want our cities to also have fantastic infrastructure, we want our cities to have a structured, well-planned growth, at the same time, we also want to provide the same exact amenities, if not the same exact, probably the best amenities that you have in the cities, which people come, you know, searching for, to be replicated in a village setting, in a rural setting as well. That is the challenge that India has today, not just Hyderabad or not just Telangana. The second thing is, while this whole point of infrastructure is a challenge, definitely, the question that looms large, a lot of people keep saying this, and I think it's John F. Kennedy who said it. America is not rich because it had highways. America actually became rich after the highway system was built in 1950s. Lots of people actually have this misconception that America actually is rich because of all the highways it has. In fact, it's the other way around. So infrastructure, as Sangeeta was alluding to, you have cities like Manhattan, you have cities like London, which have become business hubs and then expanded. But cities like Atlanta, actually Beijing, have built infrastructure, invited growth opportunities, and invited more and more people, and have grown and prospered, and actually have made very well, done very well for themselves. Hyderabad is on the cusp of a wonderful opportunity here. Yes, as a quick comparable measure, I would say this. I've been saying this repeatedly. Hyderabad today actually has some of the best infrastructure in this country, whether anyone admits to it, likes it or not, that actually is the fact. In fact, if you take a quick look at what we have around us as competition, we have Bangalore and Chennai in southern India. We have Delhi and Mumbai and Calcutta, obviously. So if you look at them, Chennai and Bangalore more closely, they're closer to home. Hyderabad actually has thrice the infrastructure of a Bangalore, but at one third the cost. In fact, Hyderabad has twice the infrastructure of a Chennai at one half the cost. So the value proposition is there, the bigger bang for buck. That's what is actually very, very attractive to a lot of investors. And as long as you are able to actually propose that value proposition, ensure that investors come in, and as our chief minister has been talking about, ensure and facilitate wonderful growth opportunities that already are here in the form of wonderful bouquet of opportunities that Hyderabad and Telangana presents. As long as you're able to offer them with a proper motive of zeroing down on corruption as well, I think half the job is done. But today, in today's new state, we have, as I said, we have to have a mix of both. We have to have a blend of welfare and development as well. And on the welfare front and development front, we have, as I said, drafted out our course of action. For example, the 60% of the population that lives in rural areas is predominantly, again, agriculture-based, dependent on agriculture. Now, we've promised to the electorate, to the citizens of Telangana, that irrigation will be a priority area. And therefore, we have started our work already. In fact, we believe that what was called minor irrigation by the erstwhile regimes, erstwhile governments, in fact, is the major source of water in Telangana. We've had a wonderful chain tank system built by the erstwhile rulers of Telangana, the Kakatiyas. If we can revive that, because it is actually in the natural, it is in coherence with nature. This chain tank system that was built, it was in coherence with nature. So you had one tank filling up, overflowing into the next one, and so on and so forth. Now, these were all systematically or unwillingly destroyed over a period of time. Now is the time for Telangana's rural areas to prosper by virtue of actually reviving these minor irrigation tanks in a big way. In fact, our governments, one of our governments' thrust areas is reviving these chain tank systems. We want to ensure, because people keep talking about water harvesting systems. Everybody in the world is talking about water harvesting. Now, that is exactly what our Kakatiyas have done, I think, centuries ago. This is exactly what was the trick. And our government is focused on reviving this chain tank. Secondly, also, we are looking at a lot of major irrigation projects as well, such as Pranahita Chevella, such as the SRSP Phase 2, such as Kantanpalli, such as Palamur Lift Irrigation Scheme. We want to do simultaneously, we want to balance both the minor irrigation projects and the major irrigation projects as well. And effectively, by the end of these 5 years, we are looking at a situation where we would want to provide irrigation to more than 75 lakh acres in Telangana, through either the minor irrigation system or through the major irrigation system. That is a goal we've set for ourselves. And the next big item as far as development and welfare goes is power. Lots of people, lots of complaints about power off late. In fact, lots of questions, and I get a lot of tweets as well on this. Whenever there's a power outage, the immediate thing that I, you know, messages or tweets I get, is this why we wanted Telangana? These are the questions I get all the time. But I'd like you to understand one thing. Unfortunately, this is a legacy that we've inherited. I don't want to blame anybody that has governed this state in the past, anybody specifically. But the fact remains, yes, Telangana has some wonderful coal resources. The coal deposits of Singareni are the biggest in South India. The biggest coal block in South India is in Singareni, and Singareni is in Telangana. Four districts, Adilabad, Karimnagar, Warangal and Khammam. We have the Godavari traversing through length and breadth of Telangana, right next to these coal deposits. What do you need to generate power, thermal power? You need coal, you need water. Unfortunately, we don't have any pithead stations that have been set up. Instead, where were they set up? One was set up in Vijayawada, the VTPS, where there was no coal. And then another was set up in Rayalaseema, where there was no coal or water. So if you think about it logically, by this time, in fact, even Andhra Pradesh should not just have been a self-sufficient state in power. It should have been a surplus power state. But unfortunately, our erstwhile regimes have not planned for this. That's exactly the legacy that we have today. That's exactly the crisis that we're grappling with today. In fact, I'm not just going to leave it at saying that, you know, they haven't done it, so that's why the problem. In fact, as soon as we took over, we assumed office, we started in the right earnest. We started working out how to resolve this power crisis. We started working out on various issues. As a short-term measure, our chief minister has actually immediately asked our energy department to procure power, to purchase power from wherever it is available. But unfortunately, the thing that we realized and we knew about it coming in fact, our chief minister actually, in his campaign speeches during the course of elections, has not shied away from this, from actually stating the fact that Telangana will have some power issues for the first 2 years. And as soon as I said, he assumed office, he issued instructions to purchase power from wherever it is available. But unfortunately, today Telangana is only connected to the southern grid. And in the southern grid, there isn't a single state which is actually power surplus, be it Karnataka, be it Kerala, be it Tamil Nadu or Andhra Pradesh. And the neighbor that we have, Chhattisgarh, is actually power surplus, but we don't have a grid connectivity there. So our erstwhile regimes have done two things wrong. In fact, haven't done two things right. Let me put it that way. One, they haven't built pithead stations. They haven't built enough thermal power generating stations with all the huge coal resources that we had. Two, they did not even think about actually building a grid connectivity to the neighboring state, which is Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand, which is again where you have huge amount of coal deposits. Had we had that today, we would have had 24 hours of power, because we, as you all know, I think as management professionals, Telangana is a surplus state, revenue surplus state. So therefore, we could have bought power at any cost from Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand had we had the grid connectivity. So therefore, we are doing three things. One, as a short-term measure, as I said, we are trying to purchase power still, wherever, because of the rains, because of the hydro power being generated, if there is any additional power available in Karnataka, we are trying to buy power from there. Secondly, as a very, very short-term thing for the next 6 months, we also floated tenders for about 1,000 megawatts of solar power. We are focusing on renewable energy as well. In fact, Mehbub Nagar district is where we are going to have this. In fact, we just had a pre-bid meeting where the response was phenomenal. We had about 400 companies and 600 representatives participating for tenders for 1,000 megawatt solar power projects. And this will be commissioned in the next 6 months. And then simultaneously, we are also working on, as I said, the grid connectivity to Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand. Because even if we do it on a war footing, it is going to take about 18 months to 24 months, unfortunately. So the next 6 months, we will have to make do with some load shedding, no doubt. But beyond that, definitely things are going to improve, because we have two thermal power generating stations which are which are works in progress in Chennur constituency of Adilabad, and one more in Bhopalpally of Warangal. And then we also, as a long-term strategy, as Sangeeta had mentioned, are also working with the central government on their promise that they had made of giving us about 4,000 megawatts of power through an ultra mega project by NTPC. We've already allotted land, and now we are requesting the union government to commence operations. And recently, our chief minister met with the honorable prime minister and also energy minister, inviting them to kickstart the NTPC project. And secondly, we are also building through our own Telangana Genco about power projects, thermal power projects, which would generate about 6,000 to 8,000 megawatts of power in the next 4 years. So I can guarantee you one thing, this government is extremely focused, and our chief minister is a man who's in a mission mode. And I guarantee you that after the end of fourth year of us assuming office, that would be 2018, June 2nd, you will see that Telangana is not just a self-sufficient state as far as power goes, but we will be a power surplus state, being capable to actually sell power to anybody who is in requirement. That's the sort of focus shift that there has been after we assumed office. And then, obviously, the areas such as drinking water, you may have noticed, we are now trying to emulate some best practices from across the country. Gujarat has done something called Water Grid, where they have integrated all the rural areas and the municipalities, and they have created a wonderful water grid, which is exactly what we are trying to replicate, but at a notch up, really. They have managed to give about 60 LPCD, 60 liters per person per day. But we are going to do, we are actually going to reach the Planning Commission target, the target that Planning Commission has set for us, 100 LPCD in the rural areas and about 150 LPCD in urban areas. We are conceiving this ambitious project. In fact, That is actually one of my departments, the rural water supply scheme. We're trying to integrate all the towns and corporations across the length and breadth of Telangana. We're trying to integrate all the existing schemes, and with about an investment outlay of over 25,000 crores, we will be able to complete this project, because our chief minister is a man, as I said. He's done this back in about 20 years ago in his constituency called Siddipet. But with an investment of about 80 crores in Siddipet across 180 habitations, he was able to give proper potable water to each and every household in his constituency. So 20 years later, we're trying to replicate the same exact model across the length and breadth of Telangana. This is a commitment that we have taken, and in the next 4 years, you'll also see that this drinking water grid will be complete. And then the other focus area, is environment and health, obviously. Environment, Telangana has a, well, as I said, it's a urban, predominantly urban state. We are focused on environment, and we are focused on the green cover as well. We have about 25% of the state is the green cover, the forest area. Now, our chief minister is somebody, again, he actually, in a mission mode, drove clean and green project in his own constituency about 20 years ago. And now today we're trying to replicate the same exact thing. And we're trying to increase the green cover from 25% to 33% in the next 3 years. So we are going to plant more than 230 crore saplings all across the length and breadth of Telangana. This is an ambitious target that we've set for ourselves. But that is something that we believe is doable. Not just planting saplings and increasing the green cover. We also started working on the green mission. In fact, as IT minister, I started what is called the retrofitting of IT parks in Hyderabad. About 124 IT parks in Hyderabad, we started a 5-point program to conserve energy, to make them green, to make them more environmental friendly. So going forward, you would see, I think most of you in this room may or may not know this, but some people started asking questions recently when these power outages were happening more frequently than before. They said, why can't we think about solar power? Why can't we insist that every single household in Hyderabad should have a solar panel on the roof? I want to ask you guys, how many of you in this room actually know that GHMC actually mandates that you have to have a solar panel on the roof when you're building a new property or a new house? Or how many of you know? Can you just get a show of hands? See, about 1% or 2%. See, the problem with our country, the problem with our state is, we have some wonderful laws that have been made, but the challenge is enforcing them. We have a wonderful constitution, probably the best in the world. But then when it comes to implementing it, we always seem to have that chalta hai attitude that Kinshuk was talking about. Chalta hai, usko ye khilao, usko ye khilao, khatam, chalo. Today, if you imagine this, if GHMC was able to mandate, if GHMC actually was on a mission mode, trying to mandate that each and every single apartment complex, each and every single commercial establishment, each and every single residence in Hyderabad, for the last 4 years, had solar panel on their roof, I'm sure we would have been a lot better. I'm not saying we would have been power surplus or something, but we would have done very well for ourselves. Unfortunately, we keep making wonderful laws, but we don't seem to implement them, and we don't seem to actually care about them. So that's something that we have to correct. In fact, when our chief minister started this whole idea of regulating the growth of the city, which is very haphazard, lots of complaints, lots of questions being asked. Why is he being vindictive? Why is he targeting a selective audience? We weren't targeting anybody. We were mainly trying to correct the anomalies that were happening in Hyderabad more frequently than ever before. We were trying to correct the anarchy here. We, as a city, have grown, yes. But have we really grown? In fact, a gentleman, I wouldn't want to name him. Yes, we've built a high-tech city. But unfortunately, we forgot to build a sewerage system right below it. That's the sort of city we live in. Every single time there's a trickle, you have all the roads being flooded, potholes with their mouths wide open. In fact, you have people missing sometimes, you know, just by virtues. I remember this case very vividly, where a woman was actually a pillion rider. She fell into one of these potholes and her body was found in Musi. Is this the sort of city we want to live in? This is exactly what we were trying to regulate. As a government, this is the first and primary duty of any government, to ensure that we have structured growth, to ensure that there is regulation, to ensure that there is a sense of discipline. And when we started doing this, we had a lot of questions. In fact, as management professionals, I think you would appreciate this. When our chief minister, he believes in a lot of homework, he believes in a lot of spade work. As soon as he took over, he started asking all the right questions. He said, okay, we achieved Telangana. Now, what are we going to do and who are we going to do this for? If we are actually setting out on an agenda, trying to figure out what do we do on irrigation, drinking water, power, housing, you know, all the other priority areas, health, education, etc., etc., who are we doing this for? Then he started asking all the questions and he got some staggering answers. When our chief minister was reviewing this public distribution system, the civil supplies as we call it, he got some staggering statistics thrown at by the officials. They told him that there are 84 lakh households in the state, but then there are about 1 crore 7 lakh ration cards. Can you believe that? We need to communicate a lot better. In fact, I have one lunch appointment, one lunch date I missed with Kinshuk. My apologies, Kinshuk, profusely. I promise you a Telangana thali and I'll get you that very, very soon. And he was just asking me again, can I actually get a Telangana thali? I said, I'll dig it and find out. I do know that there is a Rayalaseema Ruchulu right next door, but I'm not too sure there is a Telangana Ruchulu somewhere out there. So I will dig it out, find it out and ensure, if I can't find it, I'll invite you home. We are, as you may have realized, our focus is very clear. The chief minister is somebody, over the course of 13 years, I've realized something interesting. KCR Garu is a man who either you'll have no mixed opinion about him. You'll have either of the two opinions. There's no middle ground. I know that for a fact. Because I've seen him way too closely and I've seen I have lots of friends who from various backgrounds, and I do know firsthand as to what opinion they hold of us and especially our chief minister. So there's no middle ground. This chief minister is decisive. The three things that were missing in Andhra Pradesh in the last few years that really have impeded business growth, I believe. One, we did not have political stability. Two, we did not have decisive leadership. Three, yes, the global economic slowdown also hurt us. But now, as I said, you have a decisive chief minister who does not make, who does not mince words, who does not take much time in deciding. He is very decisive when it comes to it. Whether you like it or not, he is very decisive. Secondly, political stability is here, both in Delhi and Hyderabad. And thirdly, I think across the globe, things are looking up. So that's exactly why I said Hyderabad is on the cusp of a lot of great things. That's exactly why I said Hyderabad has a lot of things going for it. In fact, our chief minister has a wonderful vision for Hyderabad. Yes, some of you may accuse us of having excessive focus, obsessive focus on Hyderabad. But the fact remains, Hyderabad was the economic engine that drove the growth of the state of Andhra Pradesh. And Hyderabad will be, at least for the immediate future, at least for in the near term, Hyderabad will be the economic engine that shall drive the growth of the future state of Telangana as well. So therefore, our focus today, when I say Hyderabad, lots of people are confused. Some people ask me if Hyderabad is GHMC. Somebody else says, is Hyderabad the HMDA that we talk about? Hyderabad today has really permeated into 5 districts of Telangana. When I say Hyderabad, I'm talking about 40% of Telangana. I'm not talking merely about the good old GHMC, which only covered, the Himayatnagar to Charminar to, the city that I saw growing up. Today, Hyderabad has really permeated into 5 districts. On the one side, you can go as far as Kottur in Mehboob Nagar. On the other side, you can go as far as BB Nagar in Nalgonda. On the other side, you can go as far as Patancheru in Medak. And on the other side, you can go into Vishweshwar's constituency till Chevel almost. This is all Hyderabad. So 5 districts of Telangana today, 40% of the geographical expanse is what is the city of Hyderabad. So when I say Hyderabad, I'm talking about 40% of Telangana. And I'm not apologetic about it. Because our chief minister has a wonderful vision. He believes that Hyderabad needs to be decongested. He believes that Hyderabad has to be planned. There has to be a structured growth. We can't have this haphazard growth happening all over. He believes that we have to have all-round development across the city. He believes that we need to decongest the city so that we can have clusters of growth all around. He's been talking about a cinema city. He's been talking about a sports city. He's been talking about a pharma city. He's been talking about an education city. And this all around the city of Hyderabad. And obviously, the subject of my favorite subject and the subject that I lead, the ITIR, the Information Technology Investment Region. So we have to have this planned growth all around the city of Hyderabad. We cannot merely be happy with dominance in a few verticals such as healthcare, IT, biotech, and Kinshuk, I think rightly mentioned, aerospace. That's one area, in fact, which we are very excited about. Aerospace is something that we're looking forward to because the first investment that we were able to attract after we took office was in aerospace. Tata Advanced Systems had entered into, he's a practical man. He knows Singapore is a country which is about 710 odd square kilometers. Hyderabad is about the same size. But he knows it for a fact that you cannot replicate a Singapore in India. When we talk of Singapore, we are trying to imbibe the best of Singapore. We are trying to imbibe some of the best qualities, some of the best practices. That's all we're talking about. We're not really talking about mimicking, replicating the exact same thing. We're trying to imbibe the best. We're trying to invite the best. That's all there is to it. And we're also looking at the possibility of actually making this a slum-free city as well. In fact, we recently had a wonderful discussion with a couple of big, very big industry houses who are into affordable housing. We are looking at the possibility of, you know, the notified slums in Hyderabad. There are about 1600 odd notified slums is what we have in Hyderabad. We are looking at the possibility of rehabilitating them, trying to ensure that this city actually becomes a slum-free city in the next 5 years. So there are a lot of plans, but as Sangeeta was talking, there's this new industrial policy which has been in the offing for a while. So all in all, there are lots of plans for Telangana. I would like to close it out by saying this. Yes, two priority areas for information technology as well, the department that I head. I'll be remiss not to mention. The two priority areas for information technology in Hyderabad, where Hyderabad actually has a lot of potential and has a lot of dominance. We're the number 2 city in India for our information technology exports. The first priority area in IT, after I took charge, we started looking at innovation. Because we believed that if a Twitter or a Facebook or a WhatsApp could have been invented by somebody from Stanford or Wharton, why could it not have been done by somebody in Hyderabad, somebody from CBIT or IIT or IIIT? See, the ideas are there, but the unfortunate thing is we don't have a culture which cherishes, which nurtures research and development, which nurtures innovation. So that's exactly what we are set out to change. In fact, I think it was day before yesterday, on the 100th day of us assuming office, we entered into a memorandum of understanding with IIIT Hyderabad, with Indian School of Business Hyderabad, and with NALSAR Hyderabad and Government of Telangana playing the facilitator. We are launching the biggest incubating facility in the entire country, a technology business incubator, which will be the biggest of its kind. We also have partnered NASCOM. We are also partnering with a lot of interesting private enterprises. We are also looking at partnering with some of the prestigious institutions, academic institutions across the world. Lots of interest being evinced. So that's one thing that we are focused on. We want the next big thing to come out of Hyderabad. We want to incubate about 1500 odd companies in the next couple of years. We want to have the next big ticket items such as Twitter, Snapdeal, Flipkarts to come out of Hyderabad, and we are aware of the potential. We are cognizant of what it can do to the state's GDP and the city's GDP as well. And the second thing that we are also focusing on is in line, in coherence with the union government, NSDC, the National Skill Development Corporation, the NDLM, the National Digital Literacy Mission, we also started working on skill building. We've floated what is called TASK, the Telangana Academy of Skill and Knowledge, and we are going to actually have a consortium of the industry and a consortium of the academia, and with government playing the facilitator, we want to create industry-ready workforce by the time they graduate. So that is something that we are also focused on. There are lots of other things that we are working on, but guarantee you one thing at the end of the day, this is a government that knows what it is doing. We are not in the business of quid pro quo. We are not in the business of building palaces. We are not in the business of trying to make a quick buck. We fought really hard. We lost a lot of valuable lives in the course of this agitation. We are very, very cognizant. We know that we have actually promised a lot of things to a lot of people, and that the expectation is huge. We are very, very conscious of that. And therefore, exactly, our chief minister is a man who is in a mission mode. He is somebody who believes, as Sangeeta had said, he is somebody who truly believes that the goal is not achieved yet. The promise, the potential that Telangana has, until we fulfill it, until we achieve it, our chief minister will not rest and this state will not rest. With your cooperation, I'm very sure, I'm very confident that we will prosper as a state, we will prosper as a city, and I look forward to a wonderful tomorrow. Thank you very much.